Hi, I'm Emily Wilkinson from ODI. I'm interested in people's sort of thoughts and experiences on looking at the involvement of the private sector as a sort of collective action problem. So not just how one business might be encouraged to be involved through its particular sectoral activities, but how you can get several businesses from the same sector involved in addressing managing risk at the local level, so local government getting the business sector as a whole involved in planning decisions to make sure that sort of low risk development path is pursued. Because it would seem to me that there are, while there could be opportunities for a particular business to take up on and invest in a particular product, there's going to be competition between a number of businesses to do the same thing. So how do you negotiate and get sort of lots of businesses from the same sector involved in discussions and planning at the local level to reduce risk?
Okay. Any other questions for now? Hackable. Let's go over the back.
Hi, good morning, everybody. Jacobo Charang, I work for Plan International. I'm the head of disaster risk reduction. Question from anybody on the panel, because I think you touch it in different ways, but I would like to hear from you, how do you think that by involving business in disaster risk reduction, we are going to arrive to the I don't know how to call them, but to people on highest risk, which is people on the living under $2 a day, but you know, the people that struggles on daily basis. I don't know if you see it as a subsequent chain of generation wealth and then uplifting all the pyramid, if you want, or do you see a straight forward line to reach there?
Okay, thank you. Yes, behind you, Amy.
Alex Landet from IMT Worldwide. I was wondering if you've been already defining some specific methodologies depending on the sector, especially we're working on the disaster risk management in transport sector, and also in terms of investment decisions, how do you involve the private sector in the sense that private sector actors may be more interested in getting involved in new infrastructures development rather than reconstructing already existing infrastructures. So how do you make sure to make the right decisions in terms of costs and in terms of investments? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Lindsay in the front here.
Hi, Lindsay Jones from ODI. I'm just interested in how to get the private sector to scale up its activities, perhaps in risk transfer and risk sharing. We've seen many small pilots, so for example, the index-based microinsurance, where we've seen private sector involvement with other sort of civil society partnerships in successfully promoting risk transfer and sharing and promoting the access of that to poorer households. But for the moment, it's very much dependent on large subsidies, sort of 50% to 80% subsidies. The issue is that it hasn't really been scaled up to an extent that the private sector will be involved or be interested to be heavily involved in it. So how do we do that? Well, we found initiatives that are successful at that scale, but haven't been able to scale up. Are there initiatives that we can do both through sort of government regulation and expanding just past the subsidy stage where we see full scale blown out effective private sector risk transfer mechanisms that we can use?
Sorry, do you want to say one word about where your kind of question comes from and the kind of?
Yeah, I mean, we've done some studies recently that are looking at the spread of microinsurance in South and Southeast Asia. And the effectiveness of these mechanisms. And the message that came from that was that they are effective tools for risk transfer and risk sharing, but effectively they're bogged down in this lack of private sector involvement at that scale. So you do see that in places like India, it is compulsory to have that because they have a very big scheme there. It accesses about 9 million people. But the problem is, it's never going to expand past that due to the fact that it is so heavily subsidized. Private sector isn't interested in getting involved unless it can show it at scale and where there are sort of where the profits really expand. And if it's going to stay within this kind of pilot scheme, then there's no incentive to actually get involved. So trying to get that, both from the government side in creating the regulatory markets to expand that and to generate that interest from the private sector hasn't yet happened. So just interested to hear thoughts as to examples as to where those opportunities might lie.
Okay.
Just then one more coming from our online audience, Jan Kellett, who's a research associate at ODI as well. A lot of ODI questions here. What does this actually mean for the structure of HFA2, given it seems like the kind of there's a structural issue in HFA1 that's meant that we've really not been able to grapple or engage practically with the private sector? Is there an opportunity to kind of do something quite different? There's a lot there. Let me kind of get 1 minute for each panelist to pick up kind of one issue. Take your pick. Let's start with John.
I'll start with the collective action one. Some of the other ones were pretty complicated. I think there's some of my comments here probably apply to the other ones. I think language is really important here. If you're trying to pull businesses, and many of the developing countries, the private sector is, in comparison to the developed countries, there's a sort of an immaturity in comparison. I don't mean that in any sort of detrimental comment, but you do find a much greater level of cooperation in companies in developed countries because they start to understand that there are shared interests they can all act on together. And in immature economies, private sector economies, there is still that we're all in competition against each other type feel to it. And we certainly found that, for example, when we're doing some work in Turkey. But the key to pulling companies or businesses or whatever, whatever scale they are, in a sector together, in a country, in a city, to talk about city-wide issues, is really much about helping them understand where the value is in it for them. And it's not just about them putting effort and investment and time in it, it's about trying to help them understand, for them to work out how do they get value out of it. Because that's what people do, you know, we all do it, even if we work in the public sector. For what I'm putting in, what do I get out? What benefits does it bring? So the way to engage and create collective action is about, first of all, to focus what's in it for you. Now, that I know that sounds a bit everybody for themselves, and I don't mean it like that, because at the end of the day, when we talk about the private sector, and particularly when we go down to the community level, the private sector and the community are one and the same thing. You know, everybody in the community, in most rural areas, in most parts of the world, are also the private sector. They're the same thing. So people do understand shared interests. But I think that's the key to me. It's this language and showing where they get value from.
Thank you, John. Nick, 1 minute, please.
Okay, very briefly, I'll pick up the issue of risk transfers, and I think it also talks to the issue of private sector collective action, perhaps as well. But in a sense, the work that is happening through the political champions is trying to address some of those enormous challenges of how do you actually stimulate insurance in some of these very challenging environments where the market, in a sense, there's a certain degree of market failure or there's real problems, or where you've got, as you said, heavily subsidised schemes, or you've got very small pilot schemes which are, you know, some of them are taking off. And I think it's really trying to address the how can, you know, are there opportunities for scaling up? And I think part of the what we've tried to do is by bringing together a set of both the governments in question and also pooling the sort of resources of both donors and the private sector, is there a sort of new ways of trying to address this by, you know, particularly looking at the infrastructure that's required in order to get that sort of scaling up. But there's still, as we take this process forward, I'm sure that we'll find many, many challenges in terms of demand and all sorts of different things. So,
okay, thank you, Nick. Dan?
Yeah, 2 30-second points. So the first one on how do you create a commercially viable model that serves the base of the pyramid? I think there needs to be new business models. It's as simple as that. New business models that operate at a spatial level, to come to Emily's point, and that operate at a supply chain level to link large and small globalized business, and also to be served through new community models. So I think insurance and water, for example, can be delivered through a completely new infrastructure and business model. And I don't think we know what many of those are yet, but we need to hurry up and find out. I agree, insurance, even when it's scaled up, the marginal costs come down, but it's still not working. So we need that to be driven through the community, not by programme and government. On collaboration, I guess there's a good opportunity here to plug a new global initiative from UNISDR called RISE, which stands for Risk-Sensitive Investments. And I think this deals with a number of the issues raised today, but it particularly deals with the public-private collaboration point. You can read about it on the website, which I can circulate with the report later. But it has 8 activity work streams. It deals with the spatial piece, it deals with investment, and it deals with insurance too, as 3 of the 8 activity work streams. So maybe that's one method, but it's not going to solve all issues by any means.
Thank you, Dan. Christina.
Okay, great. So my first response has to do with how engaging businesses will help the most vulnerable communities, and I think that's the exact reason why you need public-private collaborations, both some formal ones and some of the informal ones, is the business case has to be there for the private sector to want to provide solutions to the bottom of the pyramid, and sometimes they are there, and you're seeing innovations from companies such as General Electric, which has new different types of products that they're creating to be low cost, specifically for the lowest income groups. But that being said, there is this clear space where the business case isn't there. And I think the public sector's role in providing risk guarantees and different types of de-risking solutions is one of the way through public-private collaborations, is how you're going to get them to want to engage and to make it easier for them to participate. With regards to risk transfer and sharing, I think the GetFIT program, the Global Energy Transfer Feed-in Tariff program, which is something we were involved in developing in partnership with Deutsche Bank a couple of years ago, is now being implemented and piloted in Uganda, and it's a program to scale up renewable energy investments, but I think it also really applies to investments in DRM and those that build resilience, in that it's a public-private partnership, and it really tries to evaluate the currency risks, the sovereign risks of a given region, and focuses on a sector, as Dan was highlighting, sort of the importance to focus on a given sector in building a market and getting multiple players on board, and basically apply a series of de-risking measures to help scale the energy market.
Okay. Thank you very much, everybody. I apologize, it's a bit rushed today. That's the nature of it. Thank you for the questions. Thank you to all the panelists for interesting thoughts and engagements, and thank you for the questions. Just a quick advert for kind of the rest of the series on HFA2 here at ODI. Some of the events that we are planning will be here in London in this room. Others will be overseas as part of our engagement in the kind of regional platforms that are coming over the next few months that'll be in kind of 5 continents. But where you saw information about this event, it's available on our website. The next event, I'm just kind of looking to Emily and Amy, will be announced very shortly. 30th of April. Okay. I think some of the speakers will be kind of sticking around. I think some have to leave, but please do feel free to kind of come forward and share who you are and any thoughts that you might have after the event. Thank you very much, everybody, for coming.